T. So this thing, these solutions are going to grow if this has a positive real part. So this part is imaginary, so that doesn't matter. So what matters is this thing. And obviously, if this has a real component, then the waves will grow. Okay, so the system is going to be unstable. So if the real part of omega is greater than zero, i.e. So this is our criterion for instability. Okay, so we immediately get some physics. First, we know that this is going to be maximal when k is aligned with u, right? K is the wave vector, so u is this vector. So if we have a two-dimensional disturbance, it's going to grow the fastest. Right? So this is something called Squire's theorem. Okay, so the most unstable mode is definitely going to be a two-dimensional disturbance. Okay, so that's saying so if we have a shear flow, so you say alpha equals k, beta equals zero. These are the most unstable modes, and this is a general property. Of shear flows. Okay. And now, there are two important special cases of this general analysis, which we'll consider now. So first we'll look at the case where u is equal to zero. And you say, well, that's not very interesting. What's causing the instability? Well, we do have the possibility of heavy fluid over light, which we expect to be unstable. Okay, so we think of Rayleigh-Taylor instability as being heavy over light. So we expect it to be gravitationally unstable. Okay, so here we say rho plus is greater than rho minus, u is equal to zero. So we just have the following situation. We just have gravity, which is acting to destabilize. Okay, so now via this equation, we set u equal to zero, and we see the criterion for instability. So we use our C naught from over there. Okay, so this is our criterion for instability. I.e. the density difference is greater than sigma k squared over g, which we can express as 4 pi squared sigma over g lambda squared. So that's the wavelength, wavelength of the disturbance. Okay, so this is saying, okay, so again, so this is lambda equals 2 pi over k. So this is saying basically that lambda has to be, the condition for instability is that lambda has to be greater than 2 pi capillary length, right? So we call LC equals square root of sigma over delta rho g. Okay. So things have to be sufficiently long, the wavelength has to be sufficiently long for it to be energetically favorable. So again, now we have this result, let's try and think about what it means. So you see that the system is stabilized to short wavelength disturbances. We know that creating short wavelength disturbances is energetically costly in terms of surface, because of surface tension. Right? It costs a lot of surface energy. Okay, so it's always gonna go unstable. There's always some unstable wavelength. But you can stabilize this Rayleigh-Taylor instability if you have a small enough container. Okay, so I'll show you that in a minute in a video. So if we have its width is less than the capillary length, let's say the capillary wavelength, so it's 2 pi, to be precise, rho plus minus rho minus g over sigma, so yeah, should have written that upside down, but now we've got a negative sign there, so we're fine. It's okay, so system is stable. Okay, so this sits well with your intuition. Can I use the projector now, actually? How do we bring the screen down? So that's one way of stabilizing Rayleigh plateau or Rayleigh-Taylor's by putting... we got a new projector. We're going to see if this works. So that's the one, this is one way to stabilize, but there's another, which is kind of a little more subtle. Hey. So we've been looking at shear flows. So it's something that you know pretty well. We're doing Kelvin Helmholtz, really.
Really,
This is a new, here. I just have one short video. I can just show it to you on my laptop. What's that? Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, but if there's a function, something to change the source. Command.
Oh, you sure? Hold on. Like, detect displays? Try that one.
Just Apple F7.
No, but that's for a PC. Apple, okay, F7 it says?
No, not actual F7, try F3.
F3? There isn't an F7, okay. That didn't work. Alright, let's try this. Let's try the Irish reboot here. Turn off and on. Yeah.
Could I take a look? There you go.
It does. I mean, this is being read. It's just that thing's not projecting, right?
Oh, here's the problem. Yeah. Could you please turn on the button?
Oh yeah. Well, that's on actually.
That's the cable. This one, the plug. And it's not correctly inserted.
Oh. There we go. Thanks. Okay. So all that to show you this video, which is a very simple video. But this is how you can stabilize Rayleigh-Taylor. So we know if we have a little, this is probably known to any of you who ever worked in a lab, but if you have a small container, because the wavelength is less than the capillary length, basically surface tension can support the weight of the fluid. Okay, and we saw this video before. So this is another example of Rayleigh-Taylor, right? You basically start with a thin layer of fluid, and if you turn it upside down, we're going to drive an instability, and we can now rationalize the wavelength that we see. No, this is, I think it's silicone oil. But it is basically this problem, you have heavy over light. And so, again, you guys rationalized the length scale of that last problem set. Okay, but now we can do this. So now we've done the math. Okay, so that was really all I needed that for today. If we can crank pump that. So that's one way of stabilizing is simply having a domain which is less than the capillary length. So we've just seen we can. By confining the fluid domain to a width less than the capillary length, roughly speaking, then you can stabilize the flow.
Twice.
Thanks. Okay, so another way of stabilizing, which is a little more subtle, and which might have been the case in the video we just saw, is if you have temperature gradients. Okay. Okay, so imagine that last geometry. We had a thin layer hanging to the ceiling. It wants to fall, and we know we've seen here that it's, there's always going to be some critical wavelength which should go, but I think maybe what how you can stabilize it is if you have cold, if the ceiling is cold. Okay, so then we have this fluid layer which starts going unstable to the most unstable mode, which we've just predicted. But as it does so, because it's colder here than here, the surface tension is higher here than here. Right? Because of the Marangoni stresses you have, as this thing grows, fluid gets pulled up into the thinning region. So it basically stabilizes the flow. Okay? So it's resisting the instability.
In case we say we show that we need a minimum length to have instability.
Yeah.
But what's the most unstable one? Does it grow with length?
So we can see that. You can evaluate that. So we'll actually do that right now. Okay, so so there's sort of, you can also have a kind of a heuristic argument. One can make the argument that, well, the surface energy, we know that the total energy of the system wants to go down, so if we hadn't solved the thing in its entirety, it's just nice to look at these things from many angles. So if we start with this and then put on a disturbance of this form, and the change in surface energy if we just imagine it's a 2D disturbance, then it's going to change by an amount prescribed by the change in the arc length. So the difference in that length relative to this length . So we simply have to integrate ds minus lambda so that's okay, so the change in gravitational potential energy. So the surface energy is changing, but so is the gravitational potential energy. So we can calculate that. It has the same form, so the one is that we're basically assuming that this interface is going to go unstable when the total energy is decreases. So this is going to give us the same result we got from the full analysis. But again, it's just nice to look at these canonical problems from various different angles. So it's going to go unstable when the total energy decreases. So again, we get the same result. So we can also rationalize this requirement of long wavelength instability simply from looking at the energetics. Okay, so we've looked now at heavy over light, but what about wind over water? We know that intuitively there's a critical wind speed at which waves develop on the surface, and if you look carefully, if you ever pay attention, you'll see that the most unstable modes are on the order of the capillary length. They're sort of centimetric. So let's try and rationalize this. So this is now the second application. This is called another classic, Kelvin-Helmholtz. Okay, so this here so we have now light fluid over heavy fluid, so it's gravitationally stable. So we have a situation which is gravitationally stable but destabilized by shear. Okay, so we've seen Squire's theorem. The most unstable mode is always going to have the wave vector aligned with the velocity field. So we're going to consider a two-dimensional disturbance and look to see what the most unstable mode is. Okay, so K dot U, as it appears in the stability criterion, goes to K squared U squared. So our criterion for instability now comes from here, this thing being positive, is okay, so again, this is positive. Okay, so let's write it in terms of wavelength. Rho minus rho plus. Okay. So this is our criterion for instability. So we see that we have to the wind speed has to be large enough to overcome the stabilizing influence of gravity and surface tension. Okay, so we see that this number becomes large when the wavelength becomes small, as we expect. So basically, the system is being stabilized to small wavelength disturbances by gravity. And this term, that is to say, so when this gets very small, this thing has to get very large. So again, we're stabilizing it to short wavelength disturbances through surface tension. We're seeing the large wavelength disturbances are being stabilized by gravity, right? So if we go to long wavelength, this term becomes large and forces this speed to be high. But we also see that for any lambda, there's some critical speed at which we'll get instability, right? So the thing's always going to go once the wind blows high enough.
John.
Yeah? Yeah, yeah.
You actually see that everything is periodic, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the way I'm used to see these Galvanomial instability, for example, to see that the beetles are periodic.
Mm-hmm.
Is what we have here.
Right? Right.
But usually, people, what they mean by putting as initial condition, for example, periodic function. So say that the interface is cosine or something.
Right, right.
And they see these things with you, right?
Right.
So these try to do like this, and they start to roll it. Right?
Uh-huh.
That these are periodic.
Well, true. So there is the possibility of nonlinear instability, right? So you can basically, if you give this system a real kick, that nonlinear disturbance may that disturbance may grow through nonlinear effects, right? But when you're looking, but this one, for example, this is a good example where you do expect to see the most the linear instability because you're starting off
zero,
right? And then some infinitesimal perturbation is growing and. The fastest growing one is going to be the one you see, but in shear flows you soon. So in hydrodynamic situations you will also like wind over water you'll get gusts. So you're not going to have this sort of idealized situation of perfect wind everywhere, right? And so this will change things. But it's actually quite remarkable how robust linear stability theory is. Like I think in shear flows is the case. That's really when all of this idea about non-normal modes came up, Trefethen's business, because there I think things are a little more complicated. But when you're starting from a situation which is quiescent, for example, Rayleigh-Taylor, it really does do a good job of predicting the instability. So yeah, one should bear in mind, all of the theory. Again, throughout the theory, we've assumed that the perturbations are infinitesimally small, right? We've linearized in them. So if you really put a kick on the interface, then it's not going to be, that sort of disturbance is not going to be described by this theory. Okay, so again, it's just nice to try and get the physics out. So we see that the system is stabilized to large wavelength disturbances by gravity, short wavelength disturbances by surface tension. Okay, but be that as it may, for any wavelength, there's a critical U at which the system will go unstable. Okay, so we can now plot the marginal stability curve. So basically, this is defining our U as a function of wave number or wavelength . So this critical U is defines a marginal stability curve . This is the curve. So this is describing velocity as a function of the wavelength, the critical velocity for which instability sets in. Okay, so that's our marginal stability curve. This has a minimum. Where, so we now want to say, what's the most unstable mode? So du dk is equal to zero. And to make our life a little easier, we can say where d by dk of u squared is equal to zero. And so then it follows immediately that you get minus delta rho over k squared plus sigma is equal to zero. So the critical, the most unstable wave number is delta rho g over sigma, which is basically 1 over the capillary length. Okay, so from that we can assess the minimum velocity required. So that's the most unstable wavelength, most unstable wave number, so we can assess the associated minimum speed. Really? What's that? Really, Taylor has zero velocity, right?
Yeah. So in that case, we can only estimate minimum lambda, right?
Because yeah.
You don't get a speed.
Yeah. Okay, so so the corresponding critical velocity we simply sub into our relation, we get the following. Okay, so this is the minimum velocity required to generate waves. Okay, so we can plot now u as a function of k, what we've just found. So it looks basically like this. So this is the stable regime. Okay, so this is wind blowing over water. When you hit this critical speed, wind speed, you excite instability with this wave number. Okay. And then as you increase the wind speed, you can excite a higher range of wavelengths. What's that?
Usually you should check the growth rate, right? But for that you need the wave speed. Here you are just connecting shear with wave number.
Right.
But you don't know that the wave speed of the normal modes, right?
The wave speed of the, sorry.
Usually we are looking for normal modes.
Yeah.
So there will be kx minus ct, right?
Yeah.
This c, when it becomes complex, you check the imaginary part and multiply by the wave number. And this is the growth rate. Right?
Yeah. So, the growth rate is omega, right? We have omega as a function of k, right? And we're finding the point at which it's maximized, right? So we got
the
dispersion relation, right?
And,
right. So it goes exactly. So it gives you, So basically, omega has an imaginary part and a real part, and we need the real part to go to be positive in order for the disturbance to grow, right? So I don't see the problem.
I'm used to check on, for example, the non-dimensional, for example, or
Yeah.
K times CI. CI will be the complex part of the wave speed.
Yeah.
So it will be CR plus ICI.
Well, the way we formulated it, we basically have omega T plus I K alpha X.
Right.
So it equals I, if you like, K dot X, right? And so we found omega is a function of K, and we basically then decide how this depends on that.
Right?
And we use Squier-Sim to say it's 2D, which simplifies matters. So we basically have. Yeah.
But there you are just checking for the minimum of the U. So what's the question here?
I haven't said at this particular along this particular line, let me see. What question do you want to ask? I want to ask the physical question here is, how fast do I have to have wind blowing over water to generate waves?
So that's right.
But above that, you can then ask the question, what's the optimal?
You have to go
That's right, yeah. Okay? Yeah, sorry. If that wasn't clear. but we do have the complete formulation, and you can get anything you want from the dispersion, at least effectively, right? Okay, so we just plug in numbers. We can then rationalize. So our critical velocity. Oh, is it up here? So if we sub in numbers appropriate for air and water, so it's around 650 centimeters per second. So one needs quite high wind speeds. That's about reasonable, I think. And this critical so the wavelength you see is around a couple of centimeters. So these are indeed capillary waves. Okay, and we've already seen, so when wind blows over water, as the wind increases and increases and increases, you finally hit this point, and the wavelength you're going to see is this. Okay? And we've seen already that if you have some contamination, so if you have biomaterial soap, then you'll basically kill these capillary waves. Okay, so the most unstable wavelength is going to get killed. And we saw that before, because if we have, again, some surfactant on the surface, then you generate Marangoni stresses, and so huge dissipation within the fluid. And so there's an energetic cost to these waves, which resists instability. Okay, any questions?
So, how accurate is this, motion? I mean, because you have.
It's pretty good. I mean, if you just take a flask and you blow air over it, it's about right. I mean, again, you rarely have such ideal situations in the perfectly uniform wind, but it's pretty robust, right? I mean, locally, as long as it's uniform over the sort of length scale of the waves generate, and it's a reasonable approximation. It's not bad. And then, of course, you know, if you get within the ocean, then you have multiple layers. So you have like, it's not, you don't have a clean interface, and you don't have surface tension anymore. Then you have, you know, density gradient smeared over some distance, and that's the sort of problem which he looks at. But this is an idealization. I think it would have been nice to be around when Lord Rayleigh and Lord Kelvin were around, solving all of these nice, clean problems with linear stability theory. But basically, we've seen, so in the last couple of weeks, we've seen Rayleigh plateau, which is a big one. And this one, and then we have Rayleigh-Taylor. So Rayleigh-Taylor, so imagine, so again, we've been describing it as heavy over light, right? But we're sort of assuming gravity's like this. It's also, if you have a, of course, if you have a bucket of water, and you accelerate, if this thing's accelerating greater than, faster than gravity, then the effect of gravity then becomes in that direction. So again, you can get Rayleigh-Taylor, right? So if you have a bucket of water, I'll accelerate it really quickly, then you can basically have an effect of gravity which is in this direction, and then you have Rayleigh-Taylor. And so when in these problems we were looking at in fluid sheets, for example, we had, remember we had the rim, we had a sheet, a fluid sheet like this, and it had rims which were moving like this. So we had some inflow here. So we had a fluid sheet. But because of the acceleration here, there's actually the possibility, we saw the instability developing here, and we assumed it was Rayleigh plateau. And it is, actually, but there's also the possibility if you have this local acceleration associated with motion along here, that it could go unstable also to Rayleigh-Taylor. So basically, whenever you're looking at surface tension flows with interfaces accelerating, you're basically asking yourself, is it Rayleigh plateau or Rayleigh-Taylor? Okay, and so it's usually one of the two suspects. Usually when the wavelength is 10 times the diameter, you know it's Rayleigh plateau, but you can differentiate between these two both in terms of the, by looking at the dispersion relations, looking at the fastest growing mode, and also looking at the time scale of growth. Okay, so you typically, but so these, you basically have to distinguish between the possible instabilities in the system according to linear theory. All right, very good. I got to stop early today because got a visitor. Andre told me that I had to show up at 2:30. So yeah, if any of you haven't picked up, there's a problem set. Might want to just check it out for your amusement.